academic and it's theater, and it's a place where they both meet.
We have the audience and participants for each other.
Intellectual practices, historical practices, cultural practices. Everyone, please.
Examples of women
sharing. What is it that you do? Sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
We're from all around the world. You can come and see and talk about
it. What time is it now? Kenya?
It started out about different people and about different things.
A whole sea of phenomena.
Theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's what should be done.
And in beauty, my understanding of life, relationships, death, has already changed.
So welcome, everybody, to the Martin E. Segal Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY. My name is Frank Henschkon. I'm the Executive Director and Director of Programs. Many of you, I know you've been here. Thank you, truly, for coming here to the Graduate Center and taking a time out of your so very busy life. I know how much you all do and work, but it is an important forum on cultural advocacy and policy in New York City, and we have a great program here. We will also honor the people who help us to make it happen, like Jimmy and Ed, so thank you for coming. If you have a cell phone, just take it out for this moment. I'll do the same. And I just got the larger one to make sure it's off so that it doesn't ring. So thank you for doing this. And I would like to introduce the president of the Graduate Center, CUNY, Chase Robinson, who will say a few words of welcome to you. Chase, thank you for coming.
Thank you very, very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. And it's a great pleasure to welcome you all. For those of you who are new to this building, well, the introductory slides closed with the logo of the Graduate Center. We're very much at the heart of the university as a whole. Those of you who know CUNY will know that it's in the business of teaching New Yorkers. 275,000 students are pursuing degrees at the City University of New York. Another 225,000 students do a variety of coursework at night and the weekends. And the Graduate Center, which is formerly called the Graduate Center and University Center, is very much at the heart of it. And it's the heart of it in more than one respect. One is that we sit here in the crossroads of 34th and 5th. Much more important than that is that we benefit from our own faculty, about 140, 150 extraordinarily distinguished scholars and fantastic students. Last year, one of our students won a Guggenheim. One of our students won a Pulitzer. This year, two of our faculty won Guggenheims. On our faculty, a Nobel Prize winner. I could expend the evening singing the praises of our faculty and our students. But the second and more important reason why we're at the center of the university as a whole is that we draw upon the extraordinary strengths of the campuses in a variety of ways. One is their faculty join our faculty in teaching here at the Graduate Center. And the second is that our students, we have about 4,200 students here at the Graduate Center, and of 4,200 students, about 3,800 are doctoral students. And every year they teach, as part of their training, teaching their own classes, about 200,000 CUNY students. So every year the Graduate Center is very much at the heart of the university's project of educating New Yorkers. Now, our premise here at 365 Fifth Avenue is very, very clear, that knowledge is a public good. No other graduate school in the country takes more seriously its public responsibilities, or I think generates more equity by investing more of its talent. Programs like tonight's signal that commitment, and they signal it by showcasing the importance and the intersection of art and culture and advocacy. Now, I think everyone in this room will know that few have championed that intersection. more effectively than Tom Finkelpearl, who's here tonight, and we are honored to have Tom, and Edwin Torres, the Deputy Commissioner of the New York City Department of Public Affairs. Both have demonstrated a genuine commitment to the arts, culture, and to the public good, and we thank them for being here tonight. Now, on behalf of the Graduate Center, it's a particular pleasure of mine to congratulate Mr. Torres, who is being honored this evening with the Martin E. Segal Award for Civic Engagement in the Arts, which recognizes the extraordinary advocacy and political contributions that he has made to the arts. Mr. Torres is in good company. Majority Leader Van Bramer, who will be joining us later tonight, was the recipient of this award last year, the inaugural year. I'll now turn the stage over to Brad Burgess, the Segal Center Associate, who will share more information about tonight's program. Welcome and do enjoy.
All right, hi everybody. It's good to be back in the room with you all again. Really happy that this is happening. Thank you to Carrie and Salim for helping me put this together. I'm just going to introduce Commissioner Finkelpearl very briefly. All I want to say about the creation of this award is that Marty Segal was the first chair of the first Commission on Cultural Affairs, and that's who our center is named after. So we decided to create this award last year, honoring his legacy of sort of being an endless dot connector. I'm sure many of you in the room knew him and knew of him. And it's important to recognize all of the dot connectors that help us make it happen. And you know, proudly we gave this award to Jimmy last year. And this year we might see a big increase in the arts budget. And so it makes a lot of sense to thank the people that helped make this happen. And this year we thought of Eddie because, you know, to fill in for somebody when they're going through personal problems and having to take on added responsibility, it's like, I can't even imagine at that level what it's like. And so the fact that he was still responsive and he sent me a personal email back to something that I wrote to him, I didn't expect it in a million years. I was totally caught off guard by that and very personally touched to know, and it was a challenging email. He said, you know, well, you just want to talk to a bunch of executive directors and artistic directors. What about actual artists? Are we actually going to make this program available, these ideas accessible to artists? And I thought, well, all right, that's a fair point. So I appreciate that a lot, and so it means a lot to be a part of this team presenting the award. So without further ado, I am very proud to bring up Commissioner Finkelpearl.
Thank you so much. So it's a real pleasure. I don't know if you guys know, but both Eddie and I hold degrees from CUNY, a master's in art history. Eddie has an MFA from Hunter. Both of us are Hunter types. And you know, you talked about in terms of educating the city and affordability, you know, CUNY is just the paragon. I don't know how many CUNY, like, people have been CUNY degrees or, oh my God. You know, it's, right? And no debt, right? So one of the big problems, right? How many people who didn't go to CUNY are in debt for their education? I read on the subway, I don't know, you could probably confirm this, that so what percentage come out with no debt from CUNY? 3 out of 4. 80 or 90%. And I talked to a dean from Brooklyn College, said that people who come out with debt from Brooklyn College, the average is $12,000, something like that. I don't know if those are exact statistics. But so to get over to the Eddie part of what I'm actually here to say. Oh, by the way, everybody knows that the personal problems I was going through, I had cancer, I'm fine, I'm in complete remission, which I'm happy to say. But this is a situation where I came in, I think, one day, and I said, Eddie, you're a commissioner starting on Monday, right? And Eddie, who has two kids and who didn't sign up to be commissioner, of course, this is not something he decided. I talked to the deputy mayor and the mayor, and they said, fine. But so it was something that he had to do, you know, to figure out how to do on the job immediately. And I've known Eddie for many years, and you know, of course, he was very popular around the Queen's Museum because he was a funder. But aside from that, you know, I felt like Eddie was also an advisor and a friend and a Queens resident, I might say. So, you know, obviously you have a high opinion of that person. But when I came to the Department of Cultural Affairs and I was thinking about, you know, who could be the deputy commissioner, Eddie was on the top of the list. And it's because of both his sort of calm demeanor and his judgment and his values, which I thought would be completely consistent with the kind of things we're doing at the agency. But also just a, you know, a fun guy to have around, you know, because you have to, you know, spend as much time or more than you spend with your partner as the person sitting next to you. So I would like to also commend Eddie on his sense of humor and all those other things. So 6 months I was out, and what happened during that time was everything that was underway, you know, was kept going at full speed. I want to say that, you know, there was another member of the core team of the commissioner's unit was out on maternity leave, my chief of staff. So it was a very short-staffed unit. Eddie kept it going. And I just want to say, I don't want this to be too long, but one of the main projects that Eddie is running on behalf of the agency is this diversity initiative. And this is something that we really thought about together. We ran in for the first moment, we talked to the mayor about it together. He was super enthusiastic, most enthusiastic he's been about anything that I've talked to him about since. No, which is important, because it's one of the most important things we're doing. So the, you know, obviously there was the diversity survey, which I hope everybody has seen, with, you know, absolutely appalling results, which we all expected, except they were a little bit better than national averages, but that was about it. But sort of the thoughtfulness and the, you know, being on top of the issues one after the next has been amazing to watch. Not that I expected anything different, but I know a lot of his, the colleagues from the funding community are here, and people have been, who has not either worked as a colleague or been funded by Eddie? I mean, who has? I'll put it that way, yeah. So that's most of the crowd. So if you're gonna go to an environment that is filled with, let's say, a diverse group of fabulous art leaders in New York City, I think you get a lot of hands for that. So that's a little long-winded way of saying that, you know, it's been absolute honor and pleasure to work with Eddie, and there's nobody that deserves this more. But don't think that just because you got this award, anything's gonna get easier. But with that, I wanna just, with, you know, heartfelt thanks, here is Eddie Torres.
So I've just got to say, Tom has things, other things he could be doing tonight, right? Tom could be at this dump called the Metropolitan Museum of Art, going to this thing nobody's ever heard of called the costume ball? Costume ball? Something like that. And instead, he chose first to come here and talk to us. And that's the reason I came to the Department of Cultural Affairs, because Tom makes decisions like that. The fact of the matter is that Tom is the reason that I came to the Department of Cultural Affairs. To know that, first of all, you know, when Tom and I spoke about, you know, the field and the need to really invest in the people that work in the field, you know, we look out at the cultural community and we see people who, driven by their passion and driven by their values, have chosen to make sacrifices, to show up every day, and to do work that is difficult, that is unglamorous, that is oftentimes unseen. And we really said, you know, we really need to invest in these people. Now, I've been very, very lucky. I came up close to a decade working at the Bronx Council on the Arts, where I really felt genuinely invested in by our leader, and had various subsequent experiences where, you know, through honestly dint of good luck, where I genuinely felt invested in. For a leader to go through the effort to get cancer, to give me the opportunity to spend 6 months as acting commissioner, I don't know how many other leaders would make a sacrifice like that. And Tom, it's typical of you that you would do something like that. And I just want to say thank you. The gentleman who got this award before me, the first recipient of this award, is Jimmy Van Bramer. And you know, he's tied up, and so you know, I think he's going to join us later on this evening. I do need to say something about Jimmy Van Bramer, because he's been such an advocate for this field. He's been such an ally to this field. And for me to get this award, there we are. Okay, good, perfect. I was just saying nice things about you, Jimmy. As I was saying, for me to get this award the year after Jimmy Van Bramer gets it is such an honor for me, because he has been such an advocate for this field and such an ally to this field. And it is so humbling to get this award the year after Jimmy Van Bramer gets it. Now, with all of that said, and I could sit here or stand here all evening and say things about Jimmy that you already know, but all of those things, you can match them up against this story and they would work for me. You know, recently, you know, Jimmy held a hearing at the City Council about the diversity work that we're doing. And Jimmy is a real champion for diversity and culture. And so at that conversation, our deputy legal counsel had just recently been promoted to chief legal counsel and deputy commissioner, so she's now my colleague. And so I introduced Jimmy to her. Her name's Kristen, she's great. And I introduced Jimmy to her and said, Jimmy, have you met Kristen Sakota? She's now our my fellow deputy commissioner, and she's our chief legal counsel. And he said, yes, 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 I know her. And I introduced her in the manner in which I introduced her to everybody. I say, she comes from the arts. She is herself a performer. She is a dancer. She came up through Urban Bushwomen, and she's been in Mamma Mia on Broadway. And he said, well, I do know Kristen, but I didn't know that you were on Mamma Mia on Broadway. So you must know every word to every ABBA song. And she said, yes, I do. And he said, I know every word to every ABBA song too. I'm a gay man. Now, take all of his advocacy and all of his alliance and you put it up against that line, and that's why I love Jimmy Van Bramer. I'll wrap up. For me to get to work with Tom Pickle-Pearl at the Department of Cultural Affairs, you know, I just spent a day with the capacity building team, right? We just expanded our capacity building program to serve cohorts of cultural organizations in low-income neighborhoods, right? And this was something that for me to be able to do this at the Department of Cultural Affairs is a real dream come true, because it's a real opportunity to invest in our neighborhoods, and it's important, you know? And it's something that I'm really excited about. And Perry Ann Carson, David Mendel, would you give a wave? Perry Ann and David work for our capacity building team. And the fact that we've been able to invest in our neighborhoods and to invest in our cultural organizations in our neighborhoods in this way is the kind of thing that Tom Pickle-Pearl made possible. You know, and one of the gentlemen at the meeting said at one point, after like 6 hours of our, you know, going through process, said, this could only happen during this administration. Like this really, he, like me, grew up in the South Bronx, and he said, growing up, yeah, I wouldn't even go into Brooklyn. And that's the kind of thing that really means something to us, you know? This is the opportunity for us to act as public servants, to really learn from all of you. And it's not easy to be public servants in that sense. You know, right now you guys are going through this process thanks to Kerry McCarthy and Salim Tagai and Michelle Coffey, and I have to thank you for doing this process, because this is really an opportunity where we are in the position of learning from you. And, you know, we all come up through the education system and we're basically taught that being a learner is kind of a low status position, that being an expert is a high status position. But when you're a public servant, you're really a learner. and you're here to learn from the people that you serve. And that's difficult to do, because when you learn, you have to say, I didn't know that prior to this. You have to say, I knew something, but I was wrong. And that's a tough thing to do. It's a humbling thing to do. It's oftentimes takes a lot to step up and say, I'm here to learn from you. And thanks to Tom Finkelpearl, thanks to Kerry and Michelle and Salem, thank you, Jimmy. We have the opportunity to do that with all of you. And so it is a real privilege to work with you in this way. So thank you.
So, Jimmy, we want to come up here and just go for it, even though we're a little out of order. I think everyone would love to hear what you have to say.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody, and I am the homosexual in who's been referenced so far, and all of you, please join me in Dancing Queen. Thank you very much. No, I'm not going to sing, but I do want to say thank you to everyone at CUNY. And the theater in particular. You honored me last year, and it was a very, very special moment. I have something very similar to what you now have, Eddie Torres, in my office, and I see it every day, and it means a lot to me, and I also believe very much in this gathering, because the power of advocacy is so, so important, and all of us are really brothers and sisters in this struggle. To get more for our city, for the children, for the seniors, the immigrants, for every single neighborhood, regardless of economic status, and so it means a lot. And I love being a champion at City Hall for all of you and for everything that we hold dear, along with the two folks who we've already heard from, and Tom Finkelpearl, may I add, looks dashing in a tuxedo. Absolutely dashing, and if you weren't married, and I weren't married, and you weren't straight, and I weren't gay, just saying. But he's a great, it could have been. It was just a couple of things needed to fall into place that did not. But Tom is a great man. We were talking about you earlier today at the Children's Museum of Manhattan, where we did a tour, it seems like 14 hours ago. And it's been a great day, but everyone loves Tom. Everyone loves Tom, not just because he's a nice man and because he had a health issue that he had to overcome, which he did. We love Tom because of what's inside Tom, and that he holds all of you and everything that we hold dear so, so preciously close to his heart. And he's such a champion for good in this world. And he knows that anything really, really good that matters has art and culture somewhere at its heart. So so thank you, Tom, for everything that you do, all that you mean to me, to the city, to Eddie, to every single person in this room. So a big round of applause for Tom Finkelpearl. And I was supposed to actually hand the baton to Eddie Torres, our deputy commissioner, and I'm sorry to be late, but this is also not like the Miss America pageant, you know what I mean? So I don't have to give him the crown that I had last year. He has earned it all on his own, and obviously everyone here knows Eddie Torres's work, I want to say they're a great team. They're an amazing team, and they've done amazing work, and Eddie has handled his tenure here well and unexpectedly serving as the acting commissioner, which is not an easy thing to do, but he has kept the Department of Cultural Affairs and our community strong, while our fearless leader was getting stronger. And for that, we all are very grateful, Eddie. And I know that as good and as progressive as Tom Finkelpearl is, that you share those very same core values, and all of us believe in that. So when I was asked to be here tonight to help honor you, we jumped at the opportunity, and I want to say thank you for everything that you've done for this community and all that the Department of Cultural Affairs is hard at work in trying to make sure that access and equity are our core values that we live by and that we govern by, and the people who are sitting right next to you are going to make sure that we do all the things that we're saying we're going to do, because Karen is going to, she's right there watching you, and I know she's tough, but and my job is to keep fighting for more funding with all of you. We've said that to the mayor, and I know that Tom and Eddie, you know, are in a position where what they're able to say is a little bit different than what I'm able to say and what you're able to say. But let's just say I know what's in their hearts, and if we can get $40 million this year, Tom and Eddie want $100 million for culture and the arts. So we're going to do everything we can. Was that a yes, Eddie? Was that But thank you so much, all of you, also for allowing me to be your champion at City Hall. I love this job more than anything. I love being a champion of the arts and culture in the city of New York, and working with great visionaries like Commissioner Torres and Commissioner Finkelpearl, and most importantly, all of you. We will get to the promised land. So with that, thank you very much.
I'm just gonna hand it over to you.
Okay. Awesome. Hi, everyone. So in continuation of all this gratitude that we're expressing, I'm gonna say thank you, Eddie, Tom, and Jimmy, for all of your advocacy as public officials. It's pretty awesome to see that. And I know that we are all very grateful for that. So thank you. Yes. So we're gonna continue with the celebratory theme for tonight and highlight some other wonderful work that our arts and cultural advocates are doing on the ground. But before we get started, I'll give a quick introduction and a little bit of context as to why we're all here for this forum. And thank you all for coming, by the way. So my name is Salim Tsagai, and I am with the New York City Cultural Agenda Fund in the New York Community Trust. The Cultural Agenda Fund is a collaboration of seven foundations that have pooled resources to help strengthen arts advocacy and influence cultural policy. I have to look at my notes here. And advance equity in the city's cultural sector. The fund is spearheaded by two co-chairs, Michelle Coffey of the Lambert Foundation, who's sitting back there, and Carrie McCarthy of the New York Community Trust, my boss. and we have a couple of our other funders here today, too, from the Booth Ferris Foundation. And then we also have additional funders from the Stavros Niarchos Foundation, Robert Rauschenberg Foundation, David Rockefeller Fund, and the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, which is one of our newest donors. These funders are really, really awesome to work for, and I have to say that this has been an incredible project to be a part of. So as a group of foundations, you all know that we make grants, that's what we do, but in the spirit of fostering collaboration among arts and cultural advocates, we also bring folks together for convenings, and as some of you know, we also have had a technical assistance program that we provided to arts advocates last year. So I'm going to give you a little bit of context for that, but we just want to say thank you to Frank and Brad from the Segal Center for inviting us and co-organizing this forum. It's something that they do well, and it's something that we love to do too, so it's a wonderful partnership that we've established here. And I'm going to flip my notes. Okay, some context. So between April and September last year, The Cultural Agenda Fund brought together 49 representatives from arts and cultural organizations from across the city, right? So spanning artistic disciplines, boroughs, budget sizes, staff levels, for a series of trainings and workshops. And some topics included racial justice leadership, communications framing and messaging, and then we also offered some design workshops to help advocates think creatively and generate some new ideas about projects that could help improve advocacy coordination in the city and also advance cultural equity. So at the end of that series, the fund invited proposals for planning grants from select groups to help develop their ideas into actionable projects, collaborative projects that they could potentially implement. And so in December of last year, we made six-month planning grants of $15,000 each to help these groups further develop their ideas. And so I'm really, really happy to say that all of those groups are here today to share with us a little bit more about their works in progress. And then, you know, these kind of span topics. So it's really awesome to see. So we're excited for that. And then the just so you know, the planning periods are supposed to actually end this summer, midsummer, so around the end of June, at which point the fund will then invite proposals for implementation grants, substantial implementation grants, to actually carry these projects out over the next year. So we're super excited to see where that goes. Each group tonight is going to offer a really brief presentation. We've given them strict time limits, but and we have some pretty visuals to accompany what they're going to say. So you know, we've also included on your seats a document that includes additional information about all of the projects that will be featured this evening. So you know, folks won't be able to say everything that they want to, but we encourage you to reference that document for more information and also take that with you when you leave tonight. After that, the best part, we're gonna open the floor up to a broader discussion, try and solicit some feedback from all of you about where these projects are headed, learn more about the planning processes, also try and understand some of the successes and challenges some of these groups have already accomplished, and then we're also interested in hearing more in terms of ideas that you all might be thinking of as you hear some of the stuff that's going on with these projects. So start thinking about that as folks present. We're actually gonna go in order of the program, so you'll see the names of the organizations there that are lead grantees, and they have their partners co-presenting with them. So without further ado, we're gonna get started with our first presentation from the New York City Arts Coalition and 1% for Culture.
I want to put my notes down. Thank you so much to Majority Leader Van Bramer, Commissioner Finkelberl, and Eddie. I can't think of bigger advocates for the arts. If we hadn't had you behind us, we probably wouldn't be all here as a group. And of course to Carrie and Michelle and their cohorts at the Community Trust for recognizing the critical role of advocacy in our city. I'm Ann Dennen, the co-chair of the New York City Arts Coalition, which is a 30-year-old organization composed of cultural groups, large and small, citywide, representing all disciplines. And the coalition works on the city and state level as an advocate for policy issues and increased funding for the arts in New York City. 1%, led by Heather Woodfield, was founded 6 years ago to press for increase in cultural funding to 1% of the city budget. We're at 25%?
0.21%.
Yes. Its supporters include arts organizations, businesses, elected officials, individual citizens. And since its founding, under Heather's leadership, 1% has expanded its goal to become a full-fledged advocacy organization. For more than a year, the two organizations have discussed a merger to provide the New York City arts community with one strong, robust, sustainable organization that would be a go-to place for the field. We represent all disciplines, theater, film, visual arts, dance, so on. And we would work with the many strong advocacy organizations for individual disciplines, along with the local arts councils, which are focused on a specific geographic area. As we talked with all of you in the sessions Solomon mentioned, we began to see a greater and greater need for an organization to provide services to everybody and coordinate the voices of all the groups doing advocacy. So during those sessions, Heather and I spent our time focused on how this might be achieved and what a new merged advocacy organization might look like. On the business side, we knew it had to be financially secure and sustainable, and that it needed defined programmatic goals, which would ensure it met the needs of the community. To this end, a committee has been formed to explore and facilitate, along with a professional facilitator, this transition. She happens to be in this room, Ann Coates. The committee is comprised of leaders from large and small institutions, and we're seeking input from organizations citywide. We want to define and put in place a new and stronger and more effective advocacy organization combining the strengths of the coalition and 1%. So for the last year on the program side, and by this we don't mean activities, but some of the values and priorities we've gleaned from all of you are promoting, and this is probably, it's listed first because it is first, promoting equity, inclusion, and diversity across New York. We want to work collaboratively with cultural organizations throughout New York City, which we have been doing, and we want to expand that. Define citywide priorities around cultural policy, support arts education, act as a resource for elected officials while advocating for cultural policy and funding, and act for, it's not on here, I don't think, but act for a resource for all of the arts organizations, whether it's helping you to keep lists, if it's providing introductions, if it's doing the dirty work that all of us are doing individually now, a clearinghouse, what have you. Collaboration and unity, we feel, are probably our strongest tools. And Heather's going to give you an example of how working together on a citywide campaign around this year's city budget, can make such a big impact. It's been widely supported by the majority leader, of which we're very grateful. But it's only one example of an initiative a strong, unified organization can undertake jointly.
So we wanted to present this as an example of the kind of collaboration that we have been working on and have been hoping to do. And 1% and the Arts Coalition got together with the CIGs and several program groups late last year to form a citywide campaign in support of an increase in cultural funding. I had to turn these slides in on Thursday. We now have 160 active partners in this campaign. So we're growing rapidly. These are some of the great images that we're sharing, and you can see some of the diversity of geographic location and discipline and focus of different organizations that are engaged with this campaign and are creating wonderful shared graphics. We think it's a great example of using research for the benefit of advocacy. We've created one-pagers for every single council district in the city, as well as some borough-wide one-pagers and one that's citywide. Up here we have a map of District 26, because I knew Jimmy Van Bramer would be here, and also because I live there. and some of the data that we're looking at in those, I'm going to just show you what these look like, are we look at the number of cultural organizations, we're looking at employment, we're looking at education, using the data for arts and schools, looking at artists by teaming together with the arts councils and using their data, and looking at where we're affecting seniors through the SUCASA program. And then I just want to give a little plug to please save the date for May 19th at 10 a.m. We're going to have a press conference at City Hall. It's going to feature the majority leader as well as Ruben Santiago Hudson and some other exciting guests soon to be announced. And we hope that you will all be there in support of increased funding for culture. And we hope that this new organization can build on these kinds of collaborations where we unite and bring the cultural community together, not only around issues of funding, but other policy issues. Thanks so much.
We're going to have a slideshow of images playing as we speak to you for the next 5 minutes. My name is Raquel De Anda, and I'm a member of the People's Climate Arts Collective, which is a network of artists and cultural organizers that work in service of social movements in New York City.
And I'm Tammy Shapiro. I work with Movement NetLab, which is a think and do tank that supports network social movements and network infrastructure through a variety of tools.
So we have been in a beautiful exploratory process working on a planning grant with Arts and Democracy and the Laundromat Project to essentially strengthen the skill sets of New York City artists, organizers, educators, and advocates who are wanting to work in service of social change. And one thing that we believe is that there's a huge amount of wisdom in this city that already exists of people who are looking at how arts and social change connect. And they're looking at how this works from a variety of different angles, right? Some people are working in policy, some people are working in community, some people are working in the art world, some people are looking at how to change, how to make narrative shifts. And if we think about this and think that, you know, on the table we have all of the puzzle pieces, what we're trying to do in this process is figure out how to put those puzzle pieces together. And so we're collaborating over the course of these past few months, the next couple months, in developing a citywide social movement arts program, which could be a series of trainings, workshops, mentorship programs, gatherings, experiential learning programs that directly support artists and cultural organizers working in service of social change.
So, as I said, Movement NetLab supports networks in a variety of ways. We do training for networks and network movements. We help create infrastructure. We support infrastructure. We also facilitate the overall strengthening of relationships and partnerships within a network. So that's what we're doing in this process here. Our goal is to create an overall, more connected network of artists, activists, organizers, educators, so that they can better share information, learn from each other, and improve the overall effectiveness of what they're doing, and also in some ways the efficiency, so that people can go where they need to find what they need.
I'm just trying to figure out how to work the slideshow. All right. So phase one began with mapping our current landscape. It began with mapping our current landscape and also in us wanting to spend a lot of time getting to know each other's programs. What are we doing as organizations? Who are we working with? What are our value systems? And then once we looked internally, then we started to look externally and we started to map this program. And Tammy's been, map the network that we know that we exist within. And Tammy has been helping us begin to visualize that. You might start talking about the map that you see behind us in a little bit, but that was phase one.
So we just have to do it manually.
Yeah.
So phase two is all about building relationships and finding out what's out there. So it's through a series of one-on-one conversations and interviews about what a collective program could look like with people who are engaged in creating socially engaging workshops and trainings. And so first is this one-on-one process, and then we will collectively shape what this program is going to look like through a variety of means, including an in-person gathering that's going to happen on June 7th.
So there has already been a tremendous amount of learning to date, and we expect there will continue to be. The first and maybe seemingly obvious one is that there is a very complex landscape of diverse groups that really have the desire to connect with one another and to work with one another, that at times it seems like are doing very similar work and work that is overlapping. So what we're really wanting to do is be able to create a place where we can all get to understand our work better. And you know, sometimes these groups haven't collaborated with one another, or maybe they don't even know that the other group exists. So, and one thing that we continuously return to is that we don't want to reinvent the wheel, we don't want to create something new, and really what we're trying to do is build upon existing work and look at the legacy of this work that's already been happening, look at the organizations that have been doing this work to really understand the nitty-gritty nuances and the history of it.
So there are a variety of tools that we use to help strengthen and develop networks, as I was saying earlier. We started with this process of mapping. Now, mapping isn't a directory. It's not about where people are. It's about what they're doing and what relationships exist and what relationships, if they existed, could strengthen the overall network. So we started by engaging in this process through a series of conversations. But a tool like this is only important if we do something with it. So we learn a lot through the process. The process is incredibly important. But it's not about creating a map like this just for the map's sake. It's about using it as a tool to strengthen and develop what's already existing. And that's what we're in the process of doing right now.
Great. So one last thing is just that, you know, we really are seeking an approach to social change that works both inside and outside the systems, because we believe that cultural shift precedes policy shift. And, you know, working to influence the popular discourse that surrounds institutions is an essential ingredient in getting those very same institutions to actually start to shift for us. So, thanks.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Frances Lucerna. I'm the co-founder and executive director of El Puente, which is a 34-year-old community-based human rights institution, as we like to call ourselves, located in Williamsburg. We've been working with primarily the Latino community in Williamsburg and in North Brooklyn, and focused on leadership development, holistic leadership development, and we do that primarily through arts and culture. We have, and I'm doing a solo act here, but many of my colleagues are sitting in the audience, and I hope during the question and answer we'll have an opportunity to really talk about the process that we've been going through. Our project is creating a blueprint for affordable, cultural, healthy communities. I think we all landed in a space of really understanding what is happening in the city today and the incredible leadership that we have an opportunity to really start to envision what culturally equitable communities would look like. And certainly in the space of the rezoning that's going on, the opportunity to really inform that. I think for all of the groups, natural occurring cultural districts, Groundswell, The Point, Eldershare, The Arts, Dance New York, Arts and Democracy, and Hester C. Collaborative, I think we all share a real belief that any planning that is going to involve the future of a community should be led by the people in the community, and that arts and culture are the bedrock of a vibrant, stable neighborhood, and that they must be primary and essential elements in any planning process that we're talking about. And so it is our intent to create a framework so that community-based organizations, cultural groups, artists, elected officials, local leaders, et cetera, can integrate arts and culture in large-scale neighborhood planning processes. What we're doing is really culling and pulling together the wisdom and experience of all of the organizations that have been doing this work for many, 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 many years in communities and with the people in communities, in dynamic projects, arts projects, and other projects that really give voice to the people in their communities, but also gives them the kind of support to really understand their power to create change. So in terms of this blueprint that we are creating, we have been engaged in, and we're looking at three aspects. The first is interviews, and what we are doing, every partner is interviewing elected officials, community-based organizations, arts organizations, small businesses, artists, and who have either participated in large neighborhood planning processes or who are facing the prospect of one. What we hope to really be able to integrate is their perspectives, their experience, and to really lend to our deeper understanding of the challenges facing different community stakeholders around these kinds of community planning processes, and to help develop the guiding questions for this blueprint. Some of the questions that we're looking at is, what would be useful for you in this blueprint? What does a culturally healthy community look like from your perspective? What has been your experience with rezoning and other large-scale planning processes? And what assets in your neighborhood that a planning process should really be built on? I had the opportunity to interview Councilman Antonio Reynoso, who represents Williamsburg, Bushwick, and Ridgewood. Antonio is really incredibly powerful in this process because he was a person who was really born and raised in Williamsburg. He's lived through that process and now as a leader has an opportunity to really influence it. And one of the things, as you see some of his comments here, really centered around the idea of respecting the primacy of community. And that any process or any individuals that are going to come in to do that kind of processing or process in community should really respect the people, the institutions, and the history of the community. They should do their homework by doing some mapping and understand what are the, you know, assets and the institutions and values of that community that need to be preserved and need to be built on. And also, he said something very interesting that is not up there. He said, community must drive the planning process and government should see itself as a resource to that plan, which I thought was really profound. I think what I came away with was an affirmation of the fact that arts and culture, when you focus on arts and culture in a planning process, what you bring back into that process and in the center of that process is the heart and the soul of a community. And I think very often, I think Antonio spoke about this in the interview, very often when those processes are done from the top down or from the outside of community, it's all about the technical aspects of what planning should look like and the heart and the soul of what really makes a community and what makes people feel invested and safe in their communities is really not in the equation. And I think that that was something that really moved me and I think is driving us in this plan. The second thing that we're doing is case studies. And the obvious is the obvious. Each partner is giving an example of what planning processes that are really driven by people and the people in the community really look like. We ourselves at Opuente are offering up our experience of a 10-year initiative, which we call a Green Light District Initiative, which is a 10-year holistic sustainability, community sustainability initiative. And at the center of it is our arts and cultural development of CADRE, which is our community arts development and resource exchange, which really focuses on artists of color, Latino artists primarily, who live in North Brooklyn and how and in which way they can come together as a network and a powerful network, not only to create venues to continue to be vibrant in the community, but also to lead change in the community. We also have something broad like that, as well as what you will see in the study, Groundswell, which is and we're focusing on the Transform and Restore Brownsville project that they did, which is a 2-year, 5-mural project in the community of Brownsville, And really what these case studies we hope will really give is a narrative, policy background, and of course visual examples of what cultural community planning can look like. And also we'll highlight the principles and tools we have identified that will frame the framework of the blueprint. In conclusion, I think what we hope in this process is to have some tools that we can give out to the community that they can use in reference to, something like a printed poster where they will have all of the aspects of how and in which way these processes can help can happen. We are also looking at ways that we can maybe pilot a blueprint in a neighborhood or of one of our organizations, and ways that we can potentially support that. Developing a training program and workshops out of the tools that we're going to create, so that the partners can contribute to other neighborhood processes. And finally, maybe an online platform for the blueprint to be disseminated. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. It's good to see everyone again. And while we're getting my slides up, I just want to do all my thanks, too, to the partners and the Cultural Advocacy Fund and to Deputy Commissioner Eddie Torres. And I think Jimmy Van Bramer's left, but he's right, I can be tough. and sweet. Anyway, it's been really an amazing process. I direct Arts and Democracy and Naturally Occurring Cultural Districts New York, and have been involved in three of these processes, so it's really been learning a lot. I've been entrusted to talk about the Naturally Occurring Cultural District led group, but there's a bunch of amazing partners in this, and I just want to read them really quick. Arts and Democracy, Arts East New York, Bronx Council on the Arts, Casita Maria, Friends of the Highline, Groundswell, The Laundromat Project, Mocada, El Puente, Staten Island Arts, University Settlement Goals, and the Center for Health Equity. It's what we've all come together to do is to look at how to really incorporate arts and culture in public housing in ways that really honor the leadership and self-determination of the public housing residents. And at the same time, to reconnect communities, the public housing communities, with the outlying communities that they are part of. And then what we want to do is learn from this work in public housing and use what we learn to engage in other sectors, and particularly we're focusing on public health. How this ties into advocacy, I think this is a good example of, and the slides, I should say, are just examples of the work of all of our partners with public housing residents. This ties into advocacy because you think of two things that are really essential, culture and housing, and looking at how the advocacy can connect between the two. All people have the right to a good place to live, and all people have the right to participate in their culture, and so this project is bringing those two together. The other thing that we're doing is looking at how we can really gain all these new stakeholders who are involved in this process, who will care about both housing and arts and culture, and come to all of the different tables that are where planning and policy are being made coming up. Our planning process, what we did was we really built on existing work. So we had a round table, Naturally Occurring Cultural Districts had a round table that brought all different stakeholders to the table. Some of the people here were there, and had a conversation about what are some exemplary projects and what could we be doing better. And this included city agencies, elected officials, and people doing the work in communities, and artists. And So what we did, what we heard over and over at that roundtable is we needed to talk more with residents. We needed to have these conversations. We had some residents at the table, but we needed to have more. We needed to go where people were at. So the way we've been doing that is multiple. We've looked at the groups that are already working in communities and had these conversations with residents, integrated with the artwork, in some cases ongoing mural making. In another case, with Friends of the High Line, who's here, they've hired an artist to lead an arts-led process of planning and discussion, which is going to end up with documented in an artist in a book that's created by the group. We're having dinner conversations, intergenerational interviews. We're having a group of leaders, young activist leaders that work with a number of their different activist housing groups around the city, come together and talk about how arts and culture can help with their organizing. And we issued a report coming out of the roundtable with recommendations. And with that report, you have the URL, everybody can see it, it's online now. And we're gonna have a report party where we'll report on, we'll talk about the report, but we'll also talk about what comes out of this planning process and how people can get involved in next steps. And we'll let you know when that's going to be. It's going to be in June and hopefully in one of the public housing cultural centers. Just a quick comments on things we're learning. And I just wanted to read a quote because it came, this was said at the round table, and I think it just really stuck with all of us. And this is Nicholas Dugan, who's a historian of public housing. Public housing raised city neighborhoods and substituted all the myriad spaces for arts and culture with a singular community center. How do you work your way towards rich community life when all of these spaces have been lost? And that really is our driving. This is our purpose, is to figure out how to answer that. And some of the things we're learning is that well, I already mentioned one, that we need to be listening to the residents, and the residents need to be in the leadership about figuring this out. We learned at the same time that residents are concerned about arts and culture as a possible harbinger of gentrification, and that is coming up as a concern. We need to take it seriously. We're learning that successful programs include sustained, culturally appropriate work that recognizes the talent, culture, expertise, and leadership in the housing communities. And we're learning that arts and culture, which we all say all the time, doesn't necessarily mean anything to people who haven't been included in arts and culture. So we're learning how to shift our language so that we can ask the questions in a way that people don't feel left out by the questions. And then finally, we all hear these horror stories about NYCHA and how the decades of disinvestment and how they're just trying to provide good housing. And so we've learned that, you know, we can't expect NYCHA to be in the business of producing cultural programs. But we've also learned that a lot of great programs are happening where NYCHA might be a partner, or it might be with a Department of Youth Services in the cultural centers, that we don't necessarily have to depend on NYCHA to be the leader in these programs, and that there's all kinds of opportunities out there for us, whether in planning processes around housing or they're in all the different place-based initiatives that are going on in the city, some of which have not yet included arts and culture, and we're gonna make sure they do. So again, I'll look out, we'll send an email out and let you know when our report release party is, and you're all invited. Thank you.
I think they're Thank you. Good evening. Thank you so much for having us. My name is Binta Van Joseph. I'm the Director of Marketing at BRIC. I'm joined by my colleagues and cohort representatives, Betsy Smullian, our Executive Vice President, Huang Wan, the General Manager at Mark Morris Dance Group, and Charisse Jones from Makata. We didn't have our representative from Tafana, but Tafana is also part of the cohort for this particular fellowship program. The Downtown Brooklyn Fellowship Program, and many of you who live in Brooklyn will know that this picture is old because the neighborhood has already changed. but it is a fellowship program, and we consider it a very innovative opportunity for four collaborative organizations that all happen to be co-located in downtown Brooklyn to design together a more equitable opportunity for arts managers in the space and in a neighborhood that happens to be very rapidly changing. The first organization, BRIC, as you know, is the leading presenter of free cultural programming in Brooklyn. We're happy to lead that charge. We turned 38 years old in June. The second, Mark Morris Dance Group, is a preeminent modern dance organization with deep community roots and for a long time. Tafana is another prestigious presenter focused on revitalizing the performance and the study of Shakespeare, much differently than BRIC. And last but not least, Makata, a visual art presenter with programs focused on amplifying issues facing underserved communities of color. So my colleague Betsy will take you through a bit of the detail around the project, and we would love to entertain any questions.
So you can see we're a group of four presenting arts organizations, but we cover quite a broad...
you need this mic.
So the goals for this project were to create a one-year fellowship program that would be replicable, that would create a cohort of young people and give them a route into arts administration. What we're seeing in our organizations is that the route that many young people take into arts administration, which is a very popular field, but many of them come in through unpaid internships. That's how they get their experience, or they go and do an art history or related master's program. And these requirements are both things that tend to restrict access for people who can't afford them. So we're looking to break down those barriers. We wanted to provide a paid fellowship program that's a route into arts administration that really gives people a very robust year of experience and lets them sort of start their professional networking. More broadly speaking, the point of this is to look for candidates who are from underrepresented groups, candidates of color. More broadly, bringing diverse outlooks to our organizations and increase diverse candidates available for all arts organizations in New York. What we've done so far in the last several months, we engaged in a field research study to learn about fellowship programs. Fellowship programs in the arts, fellowship programs in city government, all different kinds of fellowship programs. And we also reached out to colleges and universities around Brooklyn and to some extent around New York to find out about what the recruitment effort would look like for this kind of program and what kind of partnerships we could expect. We held a day-long conference among our group and brought in some experts in the field, including people from Oregon Shakespeare Festival, from the Choral Foundation, and Kemi, who, if you don't know, is a very successful graduate of the Walker Arts Fellowship Program, which is a really successful program that we looked at as a model. And we're now in the process of commissioning a curriculum study, because one of the things that we came to realize was that if we wanted this to be not your typical internship program, we wanted to have a very robust professional development mode. So we want this group to be coming together very regularly throughout the year and doing not necessarily a classroom, but partly a classroom program where they're getting a real basis for arts administration work. And although we're all pretty comfortable working with people day to day to help them learn arts administration. Doing a classroom thing was new to us, so we're working with a consultant who's developing a curriculum plan for us. So our program design really is in three parts. One, we're planning it as a cohort model. We want this group of young people to form and be able to support each other and learn together, start their learning community and their network. And this is a quote from the Posse Foundation, who are some of one of the forerunners of this idea that a small and diverse group can serve as a catalyst for increased individual and community development. Second thing is work experience. This is going to be a critical part of our fellowship program. We want all of the fellows to rotate through all four of our organizations so that they get a little bit of a taste. We want them to each specialize in one area of arts administration, but be able to try out at least one or maybe two others. And these are the areas that we've identified that among our organizations we can support. Marketing, development, production and tech, administration and finance, programming, and education. And finally, like I mentioned, we want the program to have a very robust professional development model. We did a lot of listening of people who have either gone through or run fellowship programs, and we think we need to mix both hard and soft skills. Some of the examples were how to read a financial statement, business writing and business speaking, and then a broad range of leadership skills. One of the examples people gave was giving and receiving feedback, communication skills. And then diversity and inclusion awareness. The overall goal is to bring different perspectives into the arts. So we want that to feature in the professional development. And that's it. That's our program.
Hi, I'm Mark Rozier from New York Foundation for the Arts. We don't have any slides. As you recall, our team was Art Works Out. Allison had volunteered to do a workout routine here while we were actually speaking, but we thought it was unfair for her to do all the heavy lifting, and so we're just going to do our thing.
So our group is, again, focusing on arts management and sort of increasing the pipeline of people that come into arts management and looking to increase the numbers of people of color who come into the pipeline. We felt that this group that is composed of seven organizations has a deep expertise in visual, literary, and performing arts communities. We are Harlem Stage. We are Brooklyn Academy of Music, the Brooklyn Museum, the LARC, the New York Foundation for the Arts, the Park Avenue Armory, and Printed Matter. Of those groups, we sat down and we thought about the issues that face all of us, some of which were just brought up, which is this underrepresentation of arts administrators, of color, and how this is really potentially a huge problem for the field. We feel that equitable hiring is vital for the strength and relevance of our organizations, both to support excellence and innovation in nonprofit leadership, and to ensure that the work we do itself is inclusive and equitable. So, we said our interest is looking at ways to increase the diversity of the workforce at New York City cultural organizations, both in terms of finding diverse candidates for job openings, ensuring appropriate hiring practices and policies, and looking at retention protocols. Because the issues that you have in terms of retaining administrators of color are not the same as you have in general in terms of retention. So Mark will talk about some of the steps that we've taken to address that, and Terry will bring up the back end of the conversation with where we have landed so far.
So in terms of lessons learned and some obstacles that we faced, our initial plan had been to send out to all of you a list of hiring practices that were sort of best practices in the field, to ask everyone to implement them and to start testing feedback and where they stood and how they were working. And at the first meeting, when all seven of us got together, we went through the list and realized that none of us could commit to actually doing all of that. Either because some organizations were large and they had a human resources department, and therefore there were certain things that they just couldn't do because they had a human resources department and they had policies in place and they had certain structures. Others because they were small and there was one person or two people who were involved and therefore they couldn't do all of that. So we took a step back on that, which Terry will talk about what that step is. And the other thing we wanted to do was do networking events for administrators of color, because we know that in fact, while everyone identifies, you know, sort of a pipeline project, the people in the group were saying, well, we're here, so where's the pipeline project? We're all here, why are we not, you know, sort of moving? And so our plan had been that we would have networking events that were not only for administrators to talk to each other, but that would have hiring managers and HR people involved so that they would start to learn who is in the field, not for poaching purposes, but when they had job listings that they could send them to a broader network of people. As we began to work on that, we realized, which you know, we perhaps should have realized sooner, that for 90% of the organizations, there's not an HR person. Like, there's not one person whose job that is. Like at NYFA, we don't have an HR department. Everyone, you know, hires their own staff. So we're sort of rethinking how we can do that so that it's not just, I mean, there's a benefit to having administrators talk to each other, but to try and get the HR component involved in that. So we're sort of retooling the networking piece to figure that out. And now Terry's going to talk about where we are.
So where we are is we retained a consultant to help us develop a survey, a really short, quick survey with the focus on how do you do retention, how do you do on diversity pieces, nothing, I mean, similar obviously to what DCLA sent out, but much, much briefer and much more offering an opportunity to sort of like really get into like, what are you doing? How do you do it? Tell us about it, with the hope of putting together some stories based on that, as far as best practices goes. We hired an organizational development person who has worked with corporations as well as nonprofits around diversity and inclusion issues, sort of help us get to the points and the questions that we really needed to ask to get the best information. And then also she's gonna help us move forward with the best way to sort of present it going forward. Some of the thoughts being, we talked about the networking opportunities, which you think are really important. There are already networks that exist that are trying to increase diversity in the field. Some, obviously, people in this room are working on that as well. We also are all part of our own different cohorts or groups of organizations based on probably discipline that have their own opportunities for networking and sharing information that we hope to tap into those as well. We've also found that mostly just from our own personal conversations and also our experience at our institutions, that the diversity and inclusion piece is a value that's an institutional value, which makes some people uncomfortable. So it's very difficult conversations to have. And so what we hope is to provide an opportunity and a place where people can feel like they can go, talk about what challenges they may have, and look to some other organization to see how they're approaching it, to see what will work best across discipline, size of organization, and that type of thing. We sent out a survey, again, really short survey, not a revolution to send out a survey, but you know, we thought it would be helpful. And then when we get the pieces back, they're gonna get analyzed, obviously. We're gonna pick out the best pieces to share and then work on maybe, I'm thinking this is the way I think, by borough to like have, you know, other existing things that are already happening in other boroughs, how can we sort of incorporate what we have learned and what opportunity there is, sort of share that information and sort of like come up similar to what some of the other groups are doing to have an ongoing conversation with people about these things, because I know from a larger organization, it's not gonna happen in any, you know, in any sort of really, really quick way, but there might be an opportunity in a smaller organization if you only have a few people sort of implement things to a much more quicker degree. And I also know that some of our ideas around increasing the candidate pool about, you know, leaving job openings open for a certain amount of time, I mean, the level of work that that's going to sort of create for the person who is like looking for someone, in addition to the person who's sort of taking in the resumes and that kind of thing. How do you sort of cope with some of those unintended sort of issues that come up? So I think that is. Was there something else you were going to say?
Just want to ask everyone to fill out a survey. You should have all gotten it on Thursday. If you're not the right person in your organization to fill it out, please pass it on to whoever is the right person in your organization to fill it out. And if you didn't get it, you know, check your spam folders. But also, you can talk to any of us, and we'll make sure that we get it out to you. It's due May 11th. We'll send out reminders, don't worry. But again, if you're not the person in your organization who deals with it, please just make sure to pass it on to that person, and then do a quick check-in with them to make sure that they have done it.
All right. Thanks.
So I know we are behind schedule a bit, and by a bit I mean maybe a lot. So I think what we're going to do is just go ahead and open it up to discussion and questions from the audience. If any of you have pressing questions for any of our presenters, we can take those now and maybe engage in about 5 to 7 minutes of discussion. No one. Okay, well, I have a question to start us off. So I know our last presenters, Mark and James and Terry, kind of addressed some of the challenges in working with other organizations, right? Especially when there are pretty big differences in terms of size, priorities, discipline, what have you. I'm wondering if some of you, some of the other presenters can speak to the challenges that come with collaboration, right? With other organizations, with artists or cultural workers, with residents. Right, the idea here, I think, is I'm reminded of something that Frances said in our workshop series last year about, you know, at the center of all this work is really building a critical mass. And in order to do that, we really have to have a variety of actors, right, engaged in this work. So can some of you speak to some of the challenges that come with collaboration, and then what's helpful in terms of moving that work forward?
On a separate subject that Heather was touching on, NYC Inspires, and this is the campaign around the $40 million request, asking the administration and the council to increase the budget split equally between the city-owned CIGs and the program groups. So that's a large body of people ranging in size from really small to really large, and the cultural institution groups, not completely, but many of them being the very large organizations, have really big staffs, and they've been working for many years on this kind of group collaboration and ask of the city. It's the first time the program groups have been so cohesively coordinated. Though we're still a long way off, I encourage all program groups to sign up at hashtag, what is it, Heather?
NYCinspires.org.
It's got a big press kit. It's got a toolkit. You can make it work for your organization. You can tweet. You can Facebook. And it's growing. And we're pleased about it. But that's the huge diversity we see.
No one else? Well, I know, so Binta and Betsy, I'm just gonna put you guys on the spot for a second. I know that you kind of have existing partnerships maybe, right, with Mark Morris to a certain extent and Mokata. So is it easier to kind of work on existing partnerships and really build those out a bit further than it is to create new ones?
I may, I'll go back a little bit to your last question, which was, what are some of the challenges and advantages of collaboration? You know, where we are in the Brooklyn Cultural District, we have so much interest in seeing where the district is going and making sure that the district continues to represent the people who were there before all the diversification, as well as grow with it. And we can't do that by ourselves. So there's always challenges. I would say the biggest challenge is just time. You know, we're trying to do something and it's the night of their gala and we can't get it done, you know. But the value of it is just huge, you know, bringing the other artistic disciplines into the fold. Different viewpoints, different audiences. So, you know, the value of it is just inexhaustible.
And we were connected prior to this by the Downtown Brooklyn Arts Alliance. So the Downtown Brooklyn Arts Alliance is an organization made up of 37 plus cultural organizations located in downtown Brooklyn. And we provide mostly leadership workshops for junior level members of the arts organizations and some professional development sharing and workshops. So if there are HR representatives across organizations, they may have a panel to share best practices with organizations that don't. So we are sort of part of that group, and actually BRIC is one of the founders of that organization. And so that at least allowed us to have an existing relationship and intent and common goal. But to Betsy's point, it's time. I mean, someone has to lead and pass the torch and baton and share and communicate back and forth. But I think we're all, the reason why we participated from the beginning is that we all want this. So even if everyone doesn't return Betsy's call, she's gonna move forward because enough people have.
And no, the only thing I would add is, you know, our goal is to try and find a sort of baseline in terms of hiring practices that it feels like all organizations, regardless of size, can implement, which we'll see whether that is a foolish pipe dream or not. But I mean, in terms of like this collaboration and this notion of size, I mean, that's what the ultimate goal is that we would then be able to say, look, here are practices that should really help you be able to improve hiring. They may not be everything, but here's a core, here's some other suggestions. And then, you know, send them out to the cohort and hopefully people can implement them and there can be some tracking to see that if in fact they are effective, which means that they could then perhaps go out to the larger cultural sector and perhaps even the larger nonprofit sector. So we'll see.
Do we have any questions? Yeah, Jennifer.
Thank you. This isn't a question really, but maybe a resource, particularly for folks doing the fellowship work and the staff retention work. All of us in our cohort, we did the Undoing Racism one-day workshop, and about 6 months ago, I started participating in something called the Anti-Racist Alliance, and I got an invitation through Coro, which many of us have done Coro also in the room, and I started going, and it's a monthly Monday meeting from 12 to 2, you bring your lunch, and it's blowing my mind, I'll say, and it's about 50 folks in the room, mostly social service workers. There's no one in the arts there, which is fascinating. And it's just deeply reminding me how complicated and long-term and deep this work is. And today's session was about informed trauma. And it was about the reminder that trauma, particularly from racism, is so generational and so old, and that if we're going to endeavor to do this work around retention and staffing and fellowships, like the organizations have to do the deep work too. And so I just offer that. You're happy to email me for the information. I think it's a pretty much an open session, but it really does come from the social service work. And these are folks doing, you know, housing, homelessness, child welfare, like really deep, traumatic work. And I've had in my mind, like, is this something that we can really learn from as a sector and step into in our own way, in our own work? Because there are different issues that we face, but it's really... I feel like my mind is kind of freaking out with how much work there is to do, but really excited that there are people who are doing it and how do we connect to them. So
you said it's the Anti-Racism Project?
Anti-Racist Alliance, and it's four organizations coming together, and it's a monthly meeting, and you can email me and I'll yeah, I don't know that, you know, all 50 of us should show up at one meeting, because that would probably get me kicked out. But I can send the information. I can talk with them about.
Thank you. Other comments or questions, Sandra?
Hello. My question is for Apuente in the group that's doing the blueprint for rezoning. This is amazing. This is an amazing project. My question is, are you just working to create a blueprint for those that are being rezoned? So much of Brooklyn is not being zoned, it's just changing. And so, for example, our catchment area is just changing. And so can the blueprint also, or will the blueprint also address issues for those organizations that are facing constant change, but that's not planned change, it's just happening?
I think definitely what our idea is and our intent is just to offer it out to all communities. I think, you know, in New York City right now, you'd be hard-pressed not to find a community that's not undergoing some kind of fundamental change. Certainly, in our experience of Williamsburg, we always call it ground zero of gentrification and, you know, development gone awry, right? But I think that's the impetus, and I think for others that are part of this group, I think we feel the urgency of really having the voice of community and the values and the vision and the hopes and the desires of community as it exists to really play a leading or be the leader in that transformation, right? And so this blueprint hopefully will just give communities and the people in communities an opportunity to say this is possible and this is the way you can do it, and these are groups that have done it and are doing it, and possibly, I think, the idea of this critical mass, mm-hmm. have an opportunity to say, and we have allies out there and potential partners who will help us do this.
Great, I think we have time for one more comment or question. Otherwise.
It's not really, I see. You should use it how you feel. It's more about your view.
Okay, well, I think we want to respect everyone's time. Some folks might have to pick up their kids or grab dinner, but we do have a so we'll have light refreshments afterward for everyone to chit-chat and meet folks if you haven't met each other already. Any last pressing comments?
One question I had for folks.
Take the mic.
Is I'm sort of wondering if anybody's imagined or is planning on imagining to scale their ideas outside of what seems possible to what seems necessary. You know, so is there a way to take to look at how many jobs you would need to create to actually hire enough administrators of color to make an impact? You know, like what is the scalability issue in the field for us to take into account? You know, it seems to me like jobs and housing are the major issues, and how do we provide housing when 40,000 people apply for 86 spots uptown at a artist housing residence? And so I'm just wondering if you've thought to scale it to the moon. You know, like what are the giant needs?
So this is around the public housing, but one thing that came up in our roundtable that I keep thinking about was a comment made by a colleague from Community Voices Heard, which organizes around public housing, and said, this is after we presented a lot of the model projects, really exemplary work going on, and they said, this is really great work, but this seems to be service-oriented, sort of about making public housing better for people rather than organizing oriented, which is about let's change the system. And so that really has stayed with me in terms of all this work, really. It's, are we sort of making the status quo a little bit better? Or are we thinking of a new status quo that really is different and equitable at its core?
Yeah, I can speak to sort of this big question too. One thing that we're trying to think about is, you know, what are the larger advocacy goals? What are the services the sector needs? And thinking about these like as things that you might not be able to offer in year one, but 5 years down the road, what does this need? What should this be built to? So trying to, you know, not dream ridiculously big, dream realistically, but think about, you know, what would a scaled up organization be? And realizing that those things can't be achieved tomorrow. So where's the long-term path to get there?
And we're thinking about, you know, if it could go beyond this cohort to the full cultural community and then, you know, in theory to the full nonprofit community. I mean, you know, we'd want to be able to sort of show that there's success, which would help make the rollout easier by saying, look, 50 incredibly varied organizations have implemented this and have shown results, therefore expand. I mean, not in terms of, oh, what would the numbers be, but certainly if it could go across the sector.
I was just saying to Eddie, if we as a cohort or community can provide that to Department of Cultural Affairs, then they can take it and run with it, hopefully. That's kind of how they can be, take the learning organization, learning from us as a community in a field. So let's keep our fingers crossed and our feet on the ground and eyes on the stars.